If you're going to be a cowgirl, you got to be tough.
The best thing about being a teen girl is getting to have a cowgirl summer. Oh, this is the Pure Boys, a Christian podcast, but God told us to change. So for the summer we're watching cowgirl flicks. Get in the action, feel the attraction. Horses and teens, oh what a dream. I wanna be free, yeah, free to ride some horses.
Man, I feel like a cowgirl.
This is our summer theme song.
Yahweh! What's up, Fudgepackers? Welcome to Pure Boys Podcast.
Yeehaw, Fudgepackers. We're taking it back. Anybody can be a Fudgepacker.
That's right.
And I will go to the grave with that statement.
Did you say we're taking it back? Because that's great. I like that.
I did.
Excellent. Yes, and.
Man, we're yes anding already? Ooh, wait, this is going to be a good episode.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Fudgepackers, hope you're having a great summer. Hope you're having a great cowgirl summer.
Yeah.
I'm Zachariah Ty Bryant.
And I am Jonathan Toilet Toilet.
The Two Toilet Kid. And this
Ooh,
week,
that's good.
Yeah, well, Shanghai Noon, you know. this week we are talking about a movie that I'm frantically trying to look up the year on because it's not a recent movie, and my internet is taking a big old dumperoonie, so I'm not gonna be able to pull. Oh, maybe I can.
98, baby.
Yeah, that's right. Perfect. Thank you. You've saved me. The 1998 classic. Kelsey Mulrooney, James Fargo classic, Second Chances.
Huge hit.
Based on a true story.
Is this our first based on a true story movie?
No, I think Wild Wild West was based on a true story.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we are the watchers, I think.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that... I'm actually kind of sure that it said something in We Are the Watchers about, like, based on true events or something like that.
Yeah. Like, this is the truth.
Yeah.
Hear us now.
That's how the movie started. Just the words on the screen. This is the truth. Okay.
How could it be anything other than the truth?
I mean, if a movie tells you this is the truth, who are you to deny that? Are you Peter denying the Lord three times? I don't think so.
Everybody believed it when it was the Blair Witch Project, and that was ridiculous.
I didn't see that movie when it came out. I saw it, like, literally maybe 3 years ago. And watching it 3 years ago, I was like, this movie sucks, right? Like, what was the big deal with this movie? But then I had to go back to, like, 1999 me when people thought it was real. Like, they really thought that they were going to watch a snuff film at the Cineplex Odeon. What a crazy concept.
It was, I think society just went insane because I remember so many people like just whispering to each other, this was real. This happened.
This is real. I have a real snuff film. Do you want to watch a real snuff film? Yeah.
Let's go to the Cineplex Odeon.
let's pay $10 and buy our popcorn and watch a snuff film at the Cineplex Odeon.
I saw it at the drive-in.
Oh,
the Blair Witch Project.
Even scarier, out in the environment, out in nature.
Out in the boot.
Oh, I bet that sounded great over your car speakers.
Yeah. All the crinkling, the crackling.
Oh, yeah, it's like my mic last week. It's great.
Shaboosh.
I'm going to see F9 this weekend, and I'm going to the drive-in to watch it. So, because the way I figure, it's a car, it's Fast 9, go see it in my car, right? That seems like the best way to see it.
Oh, we got to talk about this off-air, but I want to know some deets. I guess I'm going away this weekend. I want to see F9.
Yeah, you big jabroni. Well, sorry, I can't help you there, but maybe we'll talk about it off-air. Because before we get too far into this episode, we need to start this episode the way we start all our episodes, by talking about what movies we've seen recently. No, by the Pure Boys prayer.
God bless our podcast.
God bless all podcasts. We love
you.
Oh, Interesting.
Very interesting. Did you pick up on that, listener?
There's going to be a quiz at the end. Spot 10 things that are different in what Johnny and Zach said to each other.
You said we. I said I.
I thought we changed it to we. We thought that we changed it to we.
Yes.
Well, maybe one day we'll figure it out. Maybe one day we'll decide if it's I or we. But listeners, until then, you know, just it all starts out of the gate. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Hashtag I we.
Exactly. Hashtag I we.
Wink.
All right. Are you ready for everyone's favorite segment on the whole show, including ours and everyone's favorite segment forever and ever? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
The Kevin Sorbo Tweet of the Week.
Socialism doesn't work. Pass it on. Yeah, we love you, Kevin Sorbo.
Great
8:47 in the a.m. July 12th, 2021.
Now that is a dump text if I've ever read one.
That's socialism doesn't work.
Pass it on.
By socialism.
Exactly. he must have known what he was doing when he tweeted that. That's pretty fun wordplay, Kevin. I like that.
I think he meant voted on.
Voted on?
Yeah, democracy.
Right, vote or die, mother effer. That's what Kevin Sorbo would say.
Cool!
Remember that campaign? Why? Like, what an outrageous campaign. Vote or die, says Puff Daddy. Well.
Oh, that was Puff Daddy.
I'm pretty sure Puff Daddy spearheaded that whole thing. Or P. Diddy, as he's known around these parts. P standing for pedophile, of course.
Really?
Well, I don't know. We talked about that on a Madea episode. I think that's true. But it's probably not. I'm sure it's probably Puff.
Puff's all right.
Puffy. What a nickname. Hi, call me Puffy. No, I don't think I'm going to call you that. I'm going to call you Sean Combs.
I'm a lot like him changing my name all the time.
That's true. We're going to start calling you Puffy.
Jonathan Puffy Puffy.
Jonathan Puffy Toilet.
Puffy Toilet sounds like a good brand.
Mm-hmm.
I'd buy a Puffy Toilet.
Yeah, it's not a bad name for toilet paper either. Puffy Toilet.
Yeah, maybe like a baby toilet?
Yeah, like an inflatable toilet you take camping or something like that.
Yeah, inflatable toilets, all the rage.
And you have to suck the air out of it after. You can't just push it and deflate. You have to physically suck the air out of it. So you just have to put your face next to a poopy, peepy toilet.
Suck yeah, no air pumps out. Allowed.
The hole's too small for a pump.
Yeah.
So you gotta really haul on it.
That's most of the commercial, is us talking about the hole and the pumps.
You're not gonna believe how small this hole is. Your lungs are gonna collapse in on themselves.
You gotta get close to this hole. You can't use a pump.
Do you think someone's ever filled up like a beach ball with vape? What are the odds that that's happened?
Like a billion times every single year.
Yeah, true enough. That's a good point.
I wouldn't be surprised if every beach ball at like some sort of stadium sporting event or concert is filled with weed.
Would it? Oh, I just meant like, you know, watermelon vape. A delicious jewel.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Well, anyway, Kevin, great dump tweet as always. Your poo-poo tweets keep us going. We love
you. You enrich us all.
Mm-hmm. And thanks for the heads up telling us socialism doesn't work. I appreciate that in my country that has socialized healthcare and, you know, and other great stuff that socialism brings. This is not a political podcast. Yeah.
I've been thinking a lot about socialism lately, but I guess that's out the window because he makes some valid points.
Yeah, main point. It doesn't work, says Kevin Sorbo. Thanks, bud.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Did we make it through the whole theme song?
Pretty close.
Or did you cut it off?
I shut it off. We were pretty close, though. We had about 30 seconds left, but I bailed on it.
Ooh, 30 seconds. Didn't we come up to like 2 seconds once?
Yeah, we came pretty close, and then I was like, cutting it off. I don't want to hear the end
cutting
of it.
Cutting
it off. Tweet of the week.
Hey, that sounded great.
Mm-hmm.
Have you thought about being a professional singer for a living?
What do you think every theme song of this show is? Is me just shooting my shot and being like, maybe...
That's you.
Yeah, maybe some producer will hear me. Maybe I don't know, the guy who was a monster to Kesha will hear me. Dr. Zayas or whatever his name was, and he'll bring me on. Please.
Dr. Zayas?
I don't know what his name was. He was a real monster, though.
Dr. Zayas.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, do you want to hear my new favorite Bible quote?
Lay it on me.
All right, it's from Ezekiel chapter 23, verse 20. There she lusted after her lovers, whose genitals were like those of donkeys, and whose emission was like that of horses.
The genitals were like donkeys, so yeah, like big jennies.
But their emissions were like horses. So I'm assuming they had big old donkey D's, and they had big stinky horse farts. And she lusted after them. Oh, she was so lusty after those guys. Oh my gosh.
Don't call it arousal.
No, I've been here for you. Well, never mind. God, forgive me.
What were you going to say? Wink it at me with Morse code.
I don't even remember what I was going to say anymore. My brain went, you blew it. We're going to erase that part of your memory. We're going to erase what you were trying to say. Just get rid of it. Full purge. It was like a horse's emission. That's how quickly it came out of me.
Oh, talk about come out of me. I had a really good number two this morning.
Oh, yeah? You had me at come out of me.
Arousal.
Yeah. You know what else is arousing?
Lay it on me.
It's really loud. I gotta do something about that theme song. It's obscenely loud when I start playing it. I gotta edit that so it's quieter. But it's time for Lori Wilde's To Tame a Wild Cowboy. Just a coincidence that the author's last name is Wilde and there's Wilde in the title of the book. That's just a coincidence.
I don't think it is, man.
You know what, man? I think you're right.
Yes, and.
If you remember last week, we found out that Rhett Lockhart, cowboy daddy extraordinaire, has a big old donger. That's what we found out. It's a big reveal.
Love it.
So now, the girl, whatever the hell her name is.
The lady's back.
Tara. T, as they call her. Tara, who is nursing Rhett's daughter. She's the nurse looking after his preemie daughter. But she's like, kind of like, I don't know, maybe got a thing for Rhett? I guess we'll find out. Of course she does. Her sister, Arya, used to sleep with Rhett, and that's how she knows about his big old hog. And so they're talking. Her and her sister are talking about Rhett. And his sister goes, or her sister goes, want to know Rhett's kryptonite? Arya asks. Yes. She'd take any advantage she could get. It's Daisy Dukes. What? You know, blue jeans cut off so short that you're falling out of them.
No.
If you want to bend that man to your will, put on a pair of Daisy Dukes. He'll be putty in your hand. He's a leg and butt man, and boy, do you qualify on both scores.
What?
So there you go.
Inappropriate to say to your sister.
No, well, that's true, yeah. You got great legs and butt, sister. You got a butt that just...
So whip them out.
Whip them out. Show them off in the Dukes. Next, we have just this little fun little line here. His sultry smile caused sweat to pool between her breasts. Holy flippin' cow, she was losing her marbles. That's a good
it's
one.
It's crazy that we're teaching ladies to love having sweat between their breasts.
Yeah, that's true. Well, only if a man makes you sweat between your breasts, he's the one. There is
you
some...
might have a heart problem.
There is some utter nonsense in this book about like the one, and like this family has this thing that I don't know if we won't get to it this week, but I'll just tell it now. But Tara's whole family has this thing where each sister, when they kiss their spouse who is the one, they hear a hum in their head. They hear like a woo in their head when they kiss the one. So it's like that comes up later. We'll get to that. But first, I have to read what is maybe my favorite exchange so far in the book, because it's such a bizarre little moment. So here it is. Rhett walked to the barn door, banged his head repeatedly on the wall. You okay? Ridge's voice was thick and cottony, tinged with concern. Rhett turned to his brother once more. Not really. Just love the idea.
This guy seems super stable.
Oh, yeah, for sure. He went over and just smashed his head against the door. Are you okay? Not really. My head's all frigged up.
Yeah, he's too horny.
Anyway, that is To Tame a Wild Cowboy.
Now, ladies out there, I'm no doctor, but if you get so horny from a man that you start sweating down your breasticles,
yeah,
maybe see a doctor as well.
Oh, my Rhett was getting me so turned on, my left arm was tingling. I had sweat pooling between my breasts. I could smell burnt toast. I was just so turned on by this man.
I mean, get it. Yeah, that sounds fun.
Yeah, get it. Listeners, don't worry. You're going to get it at some point. Don't worry about that. It's coming. You're going to get it. There's a whole chapter at the end we're going to read. It's a treat. Look forward to that. It'll be a special that we put out. It won't even be in an episode. It'll be a thing you can just listen to on your own.
Yeah, that sounds like special material for sure.
For sure. It's going to be a long read. We're going to have to loop Pony a million times.
You're going to have to, like, pause and then wink at me, and that'll be my cues to, like, chime in.
To finish.
I need chime in time. Yeah.
Well, you can chime in whenever you want, partner. No, I guess not. He just froze. Oh, farts. Never mind. You can't chime in whenever you want, you loser. You're back, and you're a loser.
I really like being called a loser, apparently.
Oh, man. Hey, talk to your wife about that. That's some kink stuff right there, baby. We don't kink shame.
You know, maybe I will talk to my wife about that. That sounds fun.
Yeah, get her to poop on you.
Nah, I think, well, we'll start with frick me, you loser.
Right,
and then
exactly.
We'll move up to that.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. I mean, it would be, what a weird feeling that would be to have your wife call you a loser during sex.
Should be fun.
Especially when she's saying, frick me, you loser. Like, I don't know how to feel about this.
I love it.
I love it. Well, anyway, you're back. You're good. You lost half your notes.
I think I'm Brack, yeah.
All right.
Who cares about the last half of the film? Exactly. I know what happened.
Brack and Brack, you know? All right, well, yeah. Then let's go. Let's go. It's time for Second Chances.
Yeehaw.
Yeehaw. It's a shame we took out the music for this segment because that it does really feel like there should be something after we say it doesn't matter. Let's go, let's God.
I think all we need is let's go, let's God, because that's all I need in my heart.
Well, yeah. Let's go, let's God, you loser.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to bust. So this is a really old cowgirl movie. It's really old. It's 1998, and it looks it. It looks ancient.
Yeah, it's ancient.
Yeah. So the movie opens with just, like, a brutal car accident, and then, like, just the most intense, like, synthy John Carpenter, like, assault on District 13 or whatever it's called, Precinct 13. Just this crazy synth music, and it's, like, based on a true story. And you're like, holy cow, this is going to be a crazy movie.
Yeah, you're in it right away. Based on a true story, really draws you in. Maybe it's the generation we're from. Maybe kids today don't, like, you know, pander to that sort of thing. But based on a true story really gets you settled in for something crazy.
Well, there's been, lots of death. A few deaths, anyway, yeah.
Yeah.
But first, we got to do the first death, which is Daddy's death. A real car flipped in the middle of the road, and the cops are flipping out about it. I love that they're like, we got a woman inside, sure, got a woman out, she's unconscious, should be okay. Guy inside the car, he's totally dead. We got to cut him out. Yeah. We're going to have to cut him out.
And keep in mind, this was a real car. This wasn't like a couple of horses with some cardboard on the outside.
Laying upside down.
A real
down.
Car accident.
It's a real car. Yeah, it had multiple horsepower. It was toasted.
We got to cut him out.
We got to cut this man out. He's dead. Like, God, that's horrible.
It's really brutal.
You know, I never thought about it, but like that, it would be a really horrible... like. Being a fireman and a paramedic have got to be two of the worst jobs because, like, you just see death every day. Like, ugh.
You see the, like, worst of humankind on a daily basis. Yeah. You don't know if somebody's fingers are chopped off, somebody's ODing, car accidents.
Nope.
Like, you really see terrible things.
Yeah. You got to cut people, dead bodies out of cars. That's what you have to do. It's nutso.
You probably just think of them like cattle at that point.
Well, you probably just think, why don't we just take this car to the wrecking yard and just mush it into a cube with that guy in it? Is it really going to matter after this point? Just mush him into a cube.
Why don't we just, like, nuke this whole area and forget this ever happened?
Yeah, exactly. Why? I'd love that the head police officer turns to some guy and is like, hey, check over there to make sure we didn't miss anything. The guy goes over there, immediately finds a little girl. you guys, you sure didn't look very hard, huh? Because that little girl was 10 feet from the road, maybe. And he found her immediately.
It was 98, so they didn't have as much CG or anything, but I'm pretty sure that cop had superpowers and could smell blood.
He was part shark.
Yeah, he was part Marvel shark.
Yeah, he was hungry. He was looking for blood. He found it. Found it in that shoe and was like, ooh, this is satiating my thirst for blood. And then he found that little girl with a little bit of blood on her pants. And he was like, this will do it. This will get me all the way.
All the way? Oh, yeah. My God. I don't like the way you said that.
Oh, you know
what? You said all the way in the creepiest fashion ever.
I know. I apologize. We didn't read the movie guide. We got to read the movie guide for this movie on the PureFlix's movie guide.
Praise be.
Praise be.
This movie guide is going to blow your socks off.
Recommended age, 9+. So anything younger than that, you can't be older than the lead actress, essentially, is what they're saying here. So this movie includes strong biblical worldview showing kindness, forgiveness, and self-sacrifice. Woman prays for help. People act with Christian morals. One use of gee and dang. Multiple uses of darn. Car crash heard. Man dies in car crash, not seen. Girl seen briefly with bloody pant leg. Two instances where a horse is seen falling on a girl. Implication that men used to be alcoholics. A couple scenes with brief drinking. Girl fights with mother. Girl is mean to a horse and a girl. Girls wrestle. Man lies to protect someone's feelings. Girl disobeys authority. What more could you ask for in a movie?
Okay, so I don't know if it implies that a person used to be an alcoholic or just shows you that he is currently an alcoholic.
What do you mean? You're talking about the scene where the guy's like, don't you start drinking on me now. And he's like, I'm not going to start drinking. Don't worry. And then the camera pans and there's just a bottle of Jack Daniels on his desk. And you're like, well, what's that doing there then?
It's for drinking.
It's my fighting temptation, you know?
I was thinking of the rich cow person. Can you call him cow person?
You're talking about Dutch?
Yeah. Comes out of his car, has a swig of his flask, offers it to Katie, yeah, and then puts it back in like it's normal as hell.
No, he offers it to Dallas. He doesn't offer it to Kathy. Dutch offers his booze to Dallas, who turns him down. But yeah, he's definitely drinking and driving in a Porsche when we see him. It's very cool.
Very cool and normalized, and a little swig of hooch now and then again is it's fine.
It's the 90s. It's rural. We all got Porsches out here. It's rural California. Everyone's drinking.
It's nothing but a metal horse.
Exactly. That's all a car is.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, as Bon Jovi would put it, it's a steel horse. Everybody knows that.
Everybody in the club getting tipsy.
That's true. Did you clock that this movie looked like a TV movie? Like, it looked really cheap.
Yeah. But is that just the 90s and it hasn't been, like, HD'd yet?
I'm waiting for the HD remaster of Second Chances. I'm gonna get the Blu-ray when it comes out for sure.
I think this looks exactly like Homeward Bound did, but Homeward Bound got HD'd.
But Homeward Bound was a Disney movie. This movie is like a nothing movie. Yeah. Like I didn't recognize any of the production. The production company that made this movie. I didn't know who they were. Buena Vista? What the hell is that?
Well, it's probably the same one that did The Nanny. I can tell you that much.
Is that true?
Well, I'm just assuming since one of the main horse riders is a daughter in the nanny, and then the doctor is the main husband guy.
Is that true? That's wild.
Yeah, oh yeah.
I don't know the nanny that well, so you're talking about Hugh? Hugh the doctor?
Hugh the doctor is the main daddy.
Ooh, I hated Hugh in this movie, so I won't be watching the nanny.
That's how he became the nanny.
Second chances.
Exactly.
Yeah. So we're introduced to Sonny. 3 months go by. We're introduced to Sonny. Sonny is the main little girl. She's got something wrong with her leg from that car accident. It's never clear what it is. Something with her knee, I'm assuming?
I think it's hepatitis.
She cut her hand. She drank dirty ice cubes at a resort and got hepatitis.
Yeah, she ate a bunch of dirt after her accident.
Oh, yeah.
And then she drank wrong ice. I think it might have been hepatitis D.
Hepatitis dirt, yeah.
That's the one. We got there eventually.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny to think that it's not funny to think, but like that accident, that car rolled and that little girl was hurled out of the car. Like, she was far from the road. She must have just got launched out of that car. And yeah, the only thing wrong with her was like a little boo-boo on her knee. It's like, hey, count your blessings, girl. That's pretty lucky. Your dad died.
Like 30 to 40 feet. Yeah, I think God saved her is the implication.
That's true. Saved her so that she could do the kind thing she does at the end of the movie.
Yeah, she super Dave Osborne'd right out of that vehicle into the dirt. Got a little hepatitis.
Oh, yeah.
So what?
Small price to pay for a lifetime of horses. And maybe a new daddy?
That's the tagline.
Hepatitis D? A small price to pay for a lifetime of horses.
Oh, my leg, it's hepatitis D for sure.
Oh, no. When I read the description of this movie, I thought that she lost her leg. So I was just like waiting for her recovery to start going south and then having to get her leg chopped off. But then that doesn't happen. And I was just like, oh, she's just going to keep her leg this whole movie? Nah, okay, fine.
Is it because they kept saying cripple? Like it was cool to say?
They really said cripple a lot and gimpy.
Yeah.
It was like nostalgic to hear those words again and be like, oh, I feel like I'm 10 years old again, calling people cripples and gimps. That's a pretty fun way to live.
That's the kind of world we lived in when we were like 10 years old. It was just a bunch of cripples and gimps everywhere. Yeah.
And other words and, that we can't even say for fun anymore.
No other words. But we definitely said them on the school playground.
Oh, for sure. We screamed them at each other, driving in cars, wherever we were, at anybody. Lean out of the car window and scream it.
I thought my nickname was Cripple for like 10 years.
Well, you did suffer a pretty horrible injury to your leg, so you probably did earn that nickname for a little while anyway.
A little bit. I limped. I learned how to walk.
You did, and you learned how to run, and you learned how to howl at the sun.
Yeah, I do that a lot.
Yeah, you're a lunatic.
Well, that's the hepatitis, I think.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, the hepatitis D. So Sonny's talking to her mom, Kathy, and she's like missing her dead dad. And her mom goes, do you remember the story of the little girl who was looking out the window watching her brother bury the family dog? It's like, that's too wordy of a description, mom. Now you're just telling the story. Like, that's not... That you've already told the whole story at that point, pretty much.
Yeah, this is a weird story. And then her dad shows her a different window that has a good sight.
It's got a flower blooming over the dead body of their other dead dog or whatever. It's like a flower growing in the window. And he goes, see, honey, you were just looking out the wrong window. To which Sonny replies, but dad's dead, mom. Okay.
Bad story.
Yeah, not appropriate right now, mom. Dad's still dead. Help me out.
Three months in the dirt.
Truly.
That's what she says.
3 months in the dirt, mom. Dad's dead. 3 months in the dirt. Don't tell me stories about windows.
But she's hot for doctor, so she's moved on.
I hated that aspect of this story. We'll get to it. You have to use your leg or you'll wind up crippled. First instance, clock the first crippled. All right. How many cripples are we going to get in this movie? A few. I didn't count them all, but a few.
Yeah, I think it's time for the old Pier Boys drinking game. If you watch this movie and hear Crippled, you have to take a shot.
If you're listening to this episode and you hear Crippled or Chinamen, you have to take a shot. So that's two shots.
Luckily, the latter probably won't be said too much.
We'll
not
see.
Too many Chinamans.
Well, there's another shot, so you're already half cut.
I'm not going to say Chinaman again. Not
there's
once.
Three.
Chinaman is
that's
off
a four.
The table.
All right, no more Chinaman. Stop drinking. If you're drinking when we say Chinaman, you are going to end up wasted. Chinaman.
If you clock me saying Chinaman one more time, I'm never going to say it again, Chinaman.
That's some classic Chinaman humor right there.
Yeah.
We're going to get
canceled. We apologize to all the Chinamen out there.
That's true, yeah. But first, we have to move into a trailer park, just like Sonny and her mom. And I got to say, based on their house that they were living in, moving into the trailer park, that is a severe downgrade. That is a sad second house to live in, because I've lived in a trailer park before as an adult, and it is exactly what you're picturing. Like, it is, it's a trailer park, so you know what you're getting into.
It was one of my biggest fears when I was a kid that we would have to move into a trailer park. And then I went over to a friend's house that did live in a trailer, and it was kind of great. And I felt like society lied to me.
No, society was telling the truth. You were just a naive child who couldn't see how bad it was. That's all it was. You just didn't know.
Yeah, I couldn't see the bones.
Exactly. You couldn't see all the dead dogs that were buried in the backyard. But,
yeah.
Like, here's a quick story about the trailer park I lived in. One time, I looked out the window, and the park supervisor, the guy who does all the maintenance stuff, was driving around like the streets of the trailer park on a riding lawnmower with no shirt on at 11 o'clock in the morning, chugging a beer. And I was like, that's trailer park life. And it was like Thursday. Like, it wasn't Saturday or Sunday. It was a work day. And he was just like, gotta finish this beer before noon.
That sounds idyllic.
Here's the thing. The trailer park was terrible, but there was a charm to it. Like, I drove past the trailer park the other day and was like, oh yeah. Like, I had a lot of fun in that trailer park, but what a dump life it is. Oh my God.
There is a vibe to the trailer park, but if you can let it consume you and you're okay with it consuming you, then you're going to have a great time.
Yeah, if you're fine with being trash, then you're going to have a great time. You only came to the trailer once, I think. I think you were only there once, if I remember correctly. And that was at, like, gunpoint. I forced you to come over.
I was there at least a handful of times.
Nah, I can only remember the one time when we played Flick 'em Up, which is, hey, Cowgirl Summer, Cowboy Game. Anyway.
Never played it.
Well, fair enough. So the mom sends her daughter outside. She goes outside, immediately hears a horse whinny. And if you're in a trailer park and you hear a horse whinny, you better go, like, I think I'm having a stroke. What is happening? Where is this horse in this trailer park? Oh, it's literally right behind us. Oh, our trailer park is on the back end of a horse ranch. Well, that's a weird place.
Ideal, though. Like, how cool is that? You also get, I think, maybe the second cripple of the movie. She yells at her daughter as she's forcing her out of the trailer. You have to use your leg or else you'll be a cripple.
You're crippled!
Don't put that on me, Mom. I'm trying. My dad.
Mom, I'm going to Ben Taylor's Riding Academy, all right? Like, Ben Taylor's
what a
Riding
cool
Academy.
Cool name.
Very cool name. You know what else is cool? The aggressive horse Ginger, and how Buddy, the ranch hand, tells Ben, I don't want to tell you your business, but you have to kill that horse.
Out of the gate, you got to kill that horse. Like, that huss is a psycho.
Yeah, he's kicking my hat. I really liked
Buddy.
I liked Buddy. Anyway, yeah, did you what?
Did I clock that word? Did he call that horse a huss?
I don't know. I don't. Maybe.
I don't know if that's a word or a terminology for a horse or something, but yeah.
Maybe he's just like a good old boy, and he's like, we gotta ride that huss.
Exactly.
That huss is a killer.
I love Buddy, too.
Buddy was great. He kind of, I couldn't, he looked familiar, but then I IMDb'd him, and I didn't know him from anything, so. But loved me that Buddy. Also.
Oh, just that, like, old, craggly guy, but is also seems like a decent person.
Yeah.
A little rough around the edges.
Been married 4 times, and you go, how? What do you mean, buddy?
Well, he's got a big old donger, and he's got a lot of horses.
He must be. I got that hoss. You gonna get that donkey. So Sonny shows up at the farm, and and she shows up and just immediately goes into Ginger's pen and just walks into her pen, and Ben is like, no, don't. She just like immediately calms Ginger down, and everything is fine with Ginger, and he's just like, I can't friggin' believe what I'm seeing.
Hachi machi, look at this girl and this horse. They're getting along like a couple of school kids.
Getting along like a house on fire.
Oh, yeah, for sure. But he does scream bloody murder because he sees this very small girl go into this pen
with
a psycho horse.
With a crutch. She's using a crutch. She's not even walking. It's like, no, don't. I love when she comes out of the pen. He grabs her, a girl he's never met before, and just starts shaking her, like hard shaking her, and being like, you can't go in that pen.
Well, he is a full-sized man, and she is an 8-9-year-old girl, and
Crippled.
He just, like, claws her whole torso and shakes her,
like, her
so
head,
hard.
Her head is,
like you do not know this person. I know she almost killed herself, but you can't do that to another human being.
That was the 90s. You could shake another person's child if you wanted and get away with it.
I was shook a lot by other people's parents or random adults when
well,
I was a kid.
Well, should have friggin' behaved yourself at the grocery store.
Well, you gotta test your neck, you know?
That's true, yeah, by having someone shake you and give you whiplash.
Well, my mom did get me a shirt that said, shake me.
I'm not your child, please shake me.
Yeah, that had to be explicit or else it was unlawful.
Well, exactly. She's pretty. Yeah, she's pretty mean. Mean is the devil. All right, calm down, Ben. Like, this is a little girl you're talking to.
That's where the strong Christian worldview comes in, is calling the horse the devil.
Recognizing that the devil is mean.
Yeah, and the devil is us.
And the devil is alive.
In horse form. And this horse got injured.
The devil
is
very
upset with it.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy. But yeah, the horse is crippled too. It's got a bunged leg, just like the girl.
Did you like that scene where Buddy's cleaning that horse with the hose?
Yeah, I did. I really liked that. It felt real. When he's like, oh, you like that, don't you, boy? Oh, you like that. He's just hosing him down.
To me, it was weird. The horse, the hose is barely dripping. He's very aggressively, like, cleaning this horse.
Yeah.
I guess you got to get under that fur.
Yeah, you got to scrub it.
But Buddy was coming off like a weirdo at this moment for me.
Agree to disagree.
I don't know. He looked like he was washing a dog.
I mean,
I guess that's the same thing.
It looked like he wasn't washing a horse because we don't see the horse's head or, like, you just see, like, a chunk of its back, and he's just like, ah, you like that, boy? Ah, yeah, boy. what are you scrubbing there, buddy?
Do you think that was, like, a horse plant? Like a horse body double?
Well, I think it was I think it was 2 cars in a horse suit.
With a horse skin on it. With a horse.
Yeah, with real. They killed a horse, skinned it, wrapped it around 2 cars, and then Buddy scrubbed it with a hose.
But you get to learn that Buddy's a good guy in this scene.
Yeah, he's been married 4 times. I do like that Sonny suggests that they get physical therapy for Ginger. She's like, oh, well, maybe physical therapy will help her injured leg. And Ben just laughs at her. Like, dude, I can tell you that would 100% help this horse. Like, yeah, maybe it needs physical therapy. Yeah, right. We're just going to turn it into glue. What are you talking about?
Yeah, you dumb girl. We don't fix horses. We shoot them in the head and sell them for horse meat and glue.
Yeah, we sell them to Charles Napier to turn it into dog food.
Yeah, it's a horse cycle. They don't live long, and you murder them as quick as you can.
Mm-hmm. It's a horse blur.
Well, surgeries are like $10,000 a pop, so you pop them in the head instead.
Yeah, you gotta put that deposit down. Were you shocked to find out?
I can't believe you blew the whole load of this movie that he put a deposit in.
Spoiler alert, he puts a deposit down.
Poor Sergio.
Keep listening. Don't let this deter you from... Like, I know we spoiled the big surprise. He put a deposit down, but please keep listening. There's lots of fun.
I can just hear 1,000 clicks right now of people turning off this episode.
Well,
he put a deposit down. That's all I need.
The end. Were you as shocked as I was to find out that Dallas is Ben's ex?
Yeah, I thought she was 10 or 15 years older. Uh-huh. Like, she's a grandmother.
Uh-huh. She is.
But does that mean Ben's a grandpa?
Well, no, because that Melinda isn't his granddaughter.
I think it was just a fling.
I think it's... Well, they got married.
Yeah, but a fling marriage.
Right.
These rodeos move quick. You see, like, a flag woman with a flag, mm-hmm. and you're all flagged up.
Yep.
And then you put your flag on her.
Yeah.
And you get married.
Lay some pipe. Yeah, I just... Dallas is much older than Ben. Like, she's like an old...
Yeah.
She's like glammother. She's closer to glammother.
Not that bad. Not bad. Like, old.
Yeah, she's old. And she wears a lot of tassels on her jackets, which is very 90s, and I love it. I wish that would come back.
If I've learned anything from this movie, you gotta have, like, a cool grandma or a cool grandpa that has a lot of tassels. Isn't afraid.
Yeah. Agreed. That's how you show confidence, is by wearing tassels and being like, judge me all you want. Yeah, they get stuck in car doors all the time. Yeah, they're a pain. They suck. I hate them. But it's a fashion statement. I'm making a stand.
You know, I think you're right. I think we need to get some hide or leather tasseled jackets.
I mean, don't tease me with a good time, bro. That sounds awesome. I'm into wearing tassely leather jackets for sure.
We should go to Valu Village every single day and look for him.
We should just watch Harley Davidson and the Marlboro Man. That's probably got a lot of tassels in it.
Is that a commercial or a movie?
That's a movie starring Don Johnson and Mickey Rourke that honestly wouldn't not fit into Cowgirl Summer. It's kind of like a modern, like, rural cowboy kind of thing.
Isn't that called Wild Hogs?
Oh, God. Well, we can't ever watch Wild Hogs. We made a pact. We made a pact to never watch Wild Hogs again. It's on Disney Plus. I scroll past it all the time. I'm always tempted, but we made a pact, so...
Yeah. We're not going to go into it, but we can never watch Wild Hogs. I don't care how hard you beg us, listeners. Mm-hmm.
Well, no, there's one caveat. If it's in theaters, we can see it again.
Yep.
That's the only rule. It has to be playing at a Cineplex, and then we will go watch it.
So call your local Haiti theater and get them to air Wild Hog.
Yeah, tell them, hey, I got a snuff film for you. It's the newest, hottest snuff film. It's called Wild Hogs. Do you think
it is a snuff film.
Do you think they have horses in heaven? No. Just have that written down.
Yeah, they're not sentient, little girl.
They don't have a soul. That's crazy. What are they going to have, dogs and cats in heaven too? No. When your dog dies, it's dead, and your brother buries it in the backyard, and that's where it rots in the earth. So, tough lessons from mom.
Yeah, but this is a dark Christian worldview they're building here.
Oh, yeah. But they're not wrong. The Bible doesn't say all dogs go to heaven. The Bible says hell is reserved for dogs.
Very true. Very true. I've heard that a billion times if I had a penny.
We meet Melinda. She's like the town bad girl, or the ranch's bad girl. She's like, she's Dallas's granddaughter and protege, and
and goes on to be the daughter in the hit TV show The Nanny.
Becker. I'm blown away that there's two Nanny alums, because the Nanny would have been out at this point. It might have been over by this point. So the fact that they got them both for this is pretty amazing.
Main family of the Nanny.
Oh.
The Nanny who nannies the family.
Yeah.
This is the family.
And doesn't the husband fall for the Nanny or something?
Eventually. But it's a really will they, won't they. It's more of a won't they at the beginning, but then...
But
you know, star-crossed lovers.
I get it. Yeah, that happens. So Melinda is the mean girl of the ranch. She tells Sonny that they're going to turn ginger into dog food.
For fun.
But then turns out that she's not wrong. Sonny rushes to Ginger's pen, and Ben is there being like, yeah, so Charles Napier, you want to buy this horse turned into dog food? $400. It's yours. All the dog food you can eat. And he goes, well, yeah. But then she begs him, and it's like, I'll give you $4 for the horse. And Ben's like, all right, that's a better deal.
How cute! $4. So cute, I can't give it up. I don't want that $400.
Nah. I get $4 and I get to keep this horse. I still have to pay for it. Please, that's amazing.
Yeah, and $9,000 surgery to boot.
$10,000 surgery to boot.
Oh, so the deposit was $1,000.
The deposit was $2,000.
Really? I thought the guy was asking for $9,000.
No.
Yeah. Anyways,
hey, look. We can sit here and argue numbers all day long, but the fact is that horse is worth $4 and they invest 10 grand into it. Stupid.
This show isn't called Pure Boys, : what is your deposit?
Exactly. I don't know about you, but I really enjoyed the scene where Ginger was eating carrots out of Sonny's pockets. I was like, I want a horse to do that to me. I want a horse to eat carrots out of my pockets.
I do too, but for some reason it's off-putting. I'm a real pocket minch. I don't want anybody to go through my pockets for any reason, and it includes monkey and horse kind.
Oh, see, I thought
other animals maybe.
I thought you meant you were like a tiny mench. You were just a little mench that was pocket size. You could put you in your pocket, carry you with me everywhere. That sounds nice.
Yeah, that does sound nice. I could scream at you.
Yeah.
A lot.
And it would sound really tiny and small. It'd be very funny to hear you scream at me. And then I'd be like, back in the pocket with all the carrots. There's a big old carrot in there for you, if you know what I'm saying. And I'd shove you into my pocket.
Yeah, you're going to live off that carrot.
No! You're going to milk that carrot dry. And you'll go, what? Yeah.
Zachary and the Minch coming to you soon as Christmas.
That's right, as soon as Christmas. Well, I will say this. There's no way Melinda is going to save the Christmas ranch with her barrel riding skills, because she is knocking over barrels left, right, and center. She can't do it. It's brutal to watch.
Yeah, way, my good man. She looks like a real crappy horse person.
I would agree. Hey, Melinda, you're a child. You're a real crappy horse person.
I clocked it. Mm-hmm. I saw it, and the barrels are all over the place. She's a crappy horse person, and she turns out to be the villain of the piece, and then not the villain of the piece immediately.
Just gets not even a redemption arc, just like, I'm not the villain anymore. Okay, cool. That's good.
Well, they fight, and all good rivalries in childhood are solved by fights.
That's true. That is true. That's how you get to know somebody. You fight them.
Yeah.
As I'm sure some asshole would say that. You never know. You never truly know someone until you fight them. Well, you're a piece of garbage. How's that sound?
Oh, that's definitely the main lines in Never Back Down.
Probably, yeah. Did you find it weird when Melinda was about to like run the course again, and Ben is like, ready? Go ahead. It's just a weird, go ahead is such a weird, like, starter's pistol for something. Like, just go ahead.
Yeah.
Well, okay, I guess.
You should probably say any other thing in the entire world other than go ahead. Like, you sound like some supermarket sweep host.
Yeah, even if you said, like, ready, bang. All right, well, that's better, I guess.
Yeah, ready, bang.
Yeah.
That's way better.
Better than go ahead. Can I race? Go ahead. You don't seem that enthused, Ben.
Yeah, it sounds like somebody's letting you do their taxes. Yeah, go ahead.
Can I do your taxes? Ready? Go ahead. And you hand them your taxes. And they go, oh, thanks. This is going to take me 2 weeks. Oh, okay. Yeah, fair enough.
That's how you get the good tax deal.
Exactly. You know who gets good tax deals? Old Dutch John Hathaway, the richest man in California.
They should have left this man out of this film. Why why have Rich Dutch?
He was a weird character that didn't really make any sense. And also couldn't get the license plate Dutch for his car. Had to get Dutch 1 because he couldn't get Dutch. Money can't buy
but
everything,
number
I guess.
One.
No, that's not what's implied. It's implied that there's another... There's just a straight Dutch license plate out there that Dutch John Lollaberty or Hathaway couldn't get, so...
Couldn't they call Hollywood and just get a Dutch plate?
Nope. Doesn't exist. Gotta be Dutch one. They had to really finance that car.
Oh, they financed a lot of cars in this movie.
Did you think when Dutch met... Dutch goes to... And he's like a rich... He like runs a company, I guess. It's not really clear what his role is, but when he shows up and he's talking to Dallas and Melinda, did it feel like Dallas was going to sell Melinda to him? Like, he's like, oh, you've grown up into a beautiful young woman, and come here, let me embrace you, beautiful girl. Let me put my hand on your back and walk you into the house, beautiful girl. It's like, are you here to buy this girl? It's weird. Your relationship is bizarre.
It's definitely implied, and he's offering scholarships and hundreds of thousands of dollars,
yeah.
And it's really creepy.
Yeah.
He's a creepy man that doesn't need to be there other than to offer Melinda the world.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, and to be fair, when he meets them, he's probably half-cut. As we see later on in the movie, he's probably had a couple of sips before he gets there, so...
I think they like to refer to him as Nips.
You got a couple nips. Oh, yeah. I've heard that. Yeah. I need a little nip. Yeah. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
I'm not talking about nipples.
No.
Don't get it.
He is showing me his nipples, though, right now, and I wish he wasn't.
Well, this is a G-rated show, so of course I'm showing you my nipples.
Well, men's nipples are fine. If you show me a woman's nipple, I'll jump out of a window.
That's what Zachary left out of the movie guide was nipples are fine.
It's so many horse nipples. Don't even worry about it.
Yeah.
So, Sonny wants to ride Ginger. Once Ginger's healed, Sonny wants to ride her and become her, like, master, I guess. But her mom is like, well, we need the doctor to clear you for this. And then we get introduced to the biggest Dorcas Malorcas of this movie. My most hated character, Hugh the Doctor.
You are supposed to hate this guy, I think.
He's
supposed to be the Pierce Brosnan of Mrs. Doubtfire.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I have that written in my notes. This is a real Mrs. Doubtfire, Pierce Brosnan, Mrs. Doubtfire situation. Yes, 100% that's who he is. But you don't hate Pierce Brosnan in that movie. You're supposed to You're supposed to love Pierce Brosnan. He is a good man in that movie.
I got that now. Like, as watching Mrs. Doubtfire as a grown man, a man of means, I get that he's not the worst person in the world, but to me, he was breaking up.
Of course.
The family.
Well, you want Robin Williams to get back together with Miranda Hildebrand and then raise his kids. You want that to happen. But then when you take a step back from it, you go, no, his character is a psychopath in that movie, and he should not be around his kids. Their situation at the end is the best he could ever hope for, because what he did was, like, sociopathic. So...
Yeah. A lot of heroes turn into villains when you grow up.
That's true. Two-Face.
He's great. Yeah, Two-Face is great.
He's great.
He's the best.
He does the opposite. He starts off as a villain in my mind. By the end of the movie, I like him. I support that man. I support Harvey Dent, you know?
I love him. A lawyer? Ooh-wee, bringing in the cash? And he's got two faces?
Oh! And you can see his eyeball and into his mouth? Oh, what a treat.
Hung like a moose.
I guess so. Not
on one side.
That didn't get burned. Yeah. Well, yeah, but it's the non-burned side. The burned side of him is shriveled up and gone. But half a horse he's got.
That's cool.
So what did you like about Hugh, the creepy doctor? And we'll get... In this first scene, Hugh isn't a creep. I liked Hugh in the first scene. But then in the next scene, when him and Kathy are on a freaking date together, I was like, oh, no. I don't like you, Hugh. No.
Did I come off as liking Hugh? Did I say that? did I say those words? Well, because I hated him like you're supposed to in this movie.
You said, "Oh, Hugh, we're on different sides of the fence on this one. We're gonna have difference of opinions on this one." So I assumed you were coming into this loving him.
Okay, yeah, I did give you that impression. I said those exact words.
Yes,
but I loved hating him in this movie, I guess.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Because, like, he's a doctor, and he's just a doctor, and that's fine. But as soon as he goes, like, "Call me Hugh," you're like, oh, crap. This is going to be a crappy relationship.
He touches her hand, and you're just like, "God, you're her kid's doctor." Like, this is crossing so many lines just wildly and flagrantly.
Yeah.
What are you doing, Hugh? Don't poop where you eat, Hugh, you know?
Your insurance is not going to cover this.
No. And, like, what? So, spoiler alert, they don't end up together, Hugh and Kathy. They don't end up as a... He proposes to her, and she basically is like, "Nah, I don't think so. Continue to look after my daughter, but I don't really want to bang you, I don't think." It's just... What an awkward situation.
She bangs him.
I don't think she bangs him.
I think once. You don't think... I mean, he offers to marry her. Is that for the banging?
That's for the banging. It's the Christian worldview.
Right.
Right. They drink.
I'm on Team Doctor, though. If I was her, living in a trailer park, single mother, my husband's only been buried for 3 months.
For real.
I go with the doctor for sure.
Yeah, that's not a bad point, actually. She's living in a trailer park. He can elevate her out of that trailer park, get her back on her feet. Don't sign a prenup. Take him for a half of what he's got. Not a bad call. Then you can still end up with Ben. That's still a good choice.
Yeah.
But then now you got money. You got Dallas money, and you're sleeping with Ben, and Hugh is a memory of the past. That's a pretty good setup.
Yeah, you can do a lot with that ranch once you have the money. You can prop Ben up and frick him till you die.
You ride him bareback.
Yeah, there's a lot of bareback talk in this movie, which I thought was out of place. Out of the Christian worldview, for sure.
Oh, yeah, for sure. But, like, it's just gross that he goes on a date with her mom. I couldn't get over that. And then he was actively dating her. It was like, bro, come on, man. Don't be better.
I don't know if actively dating, because she has a cringe face on her the whole time he's talking.
Yeah,
like,
that's
any
true.
Scene where he's talking, she's just like, ugh, I don't know if I want to do this.
That first date, though, she's charmed by him. Although, he does sip the wine and go like, and then like drink it, and you see her go like, well, I'm not going to get used to that. Like, well, that's going to have to change. What the hell is that behavior?
That's what rich people do. I would have liked if the dead dad was his, like, doctor partner or something like that.
Oh, like, okay, dead dad was Hugh's, like he shared a practice with him or something.
Colleague.
Like that. Yeah, his colleague. Yeah. Okay, yeah. He was his secretary.
Yeah, exactly. And just like a wiener, a nerd.
Yeah. Yeah, and then she knew Hugh and was like, "Ah, oh, you know, my wiener loser husband was always getting in the way of this romance that was blossoming between me and Hugh. Oh, wait, no, he's kind of an obnoxious D-bag. Oh, you know what? Maybe I'll end up with this poor cowboy instead. Buddy, you ready for a fifth marriage?"
Well, that's what allows her to move on in this marriage. She wanted it to be over already and go with Hugh because he was such a dink of a secretary.
Oh, Hugh was the secretary. I thought her husband was the secretary.
No, the husband was the secretary.
Oh, okay. I like the idea of Hugh being the secretary. Her husband, the doctor, dies, and then the secretary goes, well, I guess I'll just take over his practice. I guess I'll just start practicing medicine now.
Well, he had a full degree, but he just loved being a secretary so much.
I just love answering the phones.
I love to talk to people.
I love handwriting the schedules. It's 1998. I can't. There's no computers.
Yeah, the printers back in those days were like the...
Oh, yeah. You gotta tear the strips off the side? F that. Get out of here.
Just big typewriters, basically.
Oh, yeah. I did like when Ben was unwrapping his rodeo memories. He has that box of old rodeo memories, and he takes like a bandana out and unwraps a pair of spurs that were in it, and then he puts that aside, and then he takes out another box or another like bandana and unwraps it, and there's spurs in that one too. And then he takes out a box, and I was like, there better be spurs in that box. This whole box better be just full of spurs. Then it wasn't.
He's got spurs aplenty. I was really creeped out how long this scene was and how much smelling he does.
Yeah, he's always smelling like the bottom of his boots and and his spurs and his bandanas and being like, oh, that first farm smell, you know?
Yeah, he's kind of a ground freak. Maybe that's why he likes Sonny so much, because she fell on the ground after the accident.
He's like, you got to touch the ground? Let me smell you.
The ground?
Whoa, you got to touch the ground? Come here, let me get a sniff.
Let me teach you how to ride.
So he's looking through a box of old memories, and there's a photo of him, Dallas, and a little girl. And then he has this flashback to what we'll see later on is the shot of the horse falling over. But there's like a horse like falling on a little girl, and he's just like, oh my God. And then there's just a sharp cut to Sonny running into the house screaming, Mommy, Mommy, Ginger is gone! It's like such a shift in tone. It's very intense.
Well, we have death number two, which is Ben's daughter.
We find out that a horse fell on her and it killed her. Presumably. Like, maybe she hit her head when she fell, but like, I don't think a horse falling on your leg is gonna kill you. I could be wrong. No.
Maybe the horse jumped and did like a quick 180, and then the horse like fell like right on her, like neck first.
Yeah, did a backflip. She was like, I'm teaching my horse how to do a backflip with me on it. And he was like, don't do it, honey. And she's like, watch this, Dad.
Not in the rain. Just not in the rain. Yeah.
You can backflip anywhere, just not in the rain, honey.
Because you can backflip a horse when you're a small child.
I mean, the Nitro Circus could backflip a horse, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, but they didn't have to tie so many rockets to that horse.
Oh, no. There was nothing left of that horse after the backflip. As they were doing the backflip, they lit the rockets, and all that landed on the ground was a saddle with the rider sitting in it, because the horse was obliterated.
But it was cool. Like, it reminded you of old school cartoons. But it was also like a horse done.
In our Western Fast and the Furious movie, can we have like an old Western Nitro Circus? Can we include that?
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, like, I want to see horses going off ramps and stuff.
That could be like the opening, like montage.
Well, the opening is going to be Vin Diesel grabbing a horse by the face and going, "If I was your dad, would I do this?" And then kissing the horse.
Yeah. Then they have that's the cold open. Right. And then this is the credits.
Oh, over the credits. Circus. That's sick, man. That's really sick. I love you that idea. This movie's coming together. So, Vin Diesel kisses a horse, says, if I was your dad, could I do this? He kisses a horse. Then they do the first train robbery that goes really well. Yeah. And you're like, wow,
cold
this
open.
Is nuts.
You're like, who are these guys?
Who is this man kissing a horse? We've seen everyone at this point. And then opening credits, you know, to maybe like Lit or something like that. Some sweet 90s, early 2000s band is playing. My Own Worst Enemy is playing. And then Nitro Circus horses. Horses doing backflips off of ramps. Horses flying in the air and people doing Supermans off of them.
All kinds of horse stunts. Going nuts in the crowd. Drinking and smoking.
Oh, they're loving it.
Going crazy.
God, I love it.
I think all
of
our actors should be like bad lookalikes.
Sure. Yeah. Just a bald man and like a Mexican woman. Yeah, we can do that. We can find those people. Yeah.
Tank top, but not really the body.
Are you talking about when I wear tank tops?
No, well, I love you when you wear tank tops.
I'm talking about it. Well, anyway, Nitro Circus, if you're listening, hit us up. We'd love to watch you do horse tricks. Can you do that? Is that a thing you do?
How much money will it take for you to do horse tricks? And I'm betting it's nothing, because it sounds so effing cool.
Sounds like nothing could possibly go wrong during the training or the production of it. Everything will work out great for these horse tricks.
There's an excess of horses in this Americas.
Of course.
And we got to solve it by strapping rockets to them and seeing what happens.
I want to see how many school buses a horse can jump. Show me.
With the aid of rockets.
No, straight up. I just want to see a horse jump a school bus. How many can a horse jump? Train that horse up.
You would just have a horse at full gallop running towards the bus and smacking into it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, there'd be a ramp. It would ramp off a ramp, of course. How else is it going to get the air it needs?
Would just double forward into a bus.
Yeah.
You just watch that over and over again with different horses.
Well, and knowing that during the training for this stunt, like, 100 horses were killed. Like, just knowing that
at least
Wild West Nitro Circus is just soaked in the blood of horses. The ground is red and wet. There's so many. You're riding on just a pile of dead horses. That's how you get good.
That's practice, baby.
Yeah. If you can teach a horse to dive off a diving board, you can teach a horse to run full gallop off of a ramp and over 8 to 10 school buses.
This movie is either going to cost us a lot in horse deaths.
Yes.
Or a lot in CGI.
There will be.
And I think it's going to be horse deaths.
There will be no Humane Society disclaimer at the end that's like, no animals were harmed. We're going to say up front, this is how many horses we killed making the opening credits of this movie. Each time there's a horse stunt, we'll put up a number that's like, during this stunt, 4 horses were killed. And then the next...
40 horses.
Yeah. The big one where they jump the buses, that a little graphic will come up that'll be like, 200 horses were killed in the making of this stunt. This was the only horse that made it. All the rest of them
died.
Not
the movie.
No.
This stunt.
This is just... the opening credits. We never see these characters again. This is just for the opening credits of Wild West Fast and the Furious.
Maybe after every stunt, we should do an aside with us in director's chairs and our head are just in our hands going, okay, so this one caused a lot of horse deaths. I don't even want to say the number, but it was definitely 452 horses that perished.
We wanted to have a big crowd shot of horses. Who knew that they'd get spooked and trample each other and kill 400 of them? I mean, we killed the extra 50 for fun. If you've already killed 400 horses that day, what's 50 more? Whatever. We got the shot.
What happened, happened.
Exactly.
Move on.
Hoof hearted, all right?
Yeah, we're gonna do that.
I can't wait for Western Nitro Circus. That's going to be sick. Sick as frick, man. That's going to be awesome.
Yeah, Fast and the Furious mixed with Nitro Circus and horses.
Oh, the deaths are unprecedented.
There isn't any precedent.
No. So Melinda is so cruel to Sonny in this scene. Like, Sonny is upset because Ginger is gone, and Melinda is in a pen going, "Bark, bark, bark, bark. Oh, they turned your horse into dog food." Like, literally, that's what she says. It's like, that's so mean.
You gotta have a mean girl in these movies. Well, it just works.
Mm-hmm. But then Sonny tackles her, and they wrestle on the ground until Ben comes up, scolds Melinda, and she immediately crumples. Like, much like the other horse movie we watched. Gift Horse? What was the one with the very rich girl and then the girl working there and the guy from Dukes of Hazzard was in it? You know what I'm talking about?
It was probably Gift Horse. It wasn't A Christmas Ranch.
No.
I think it was Gift Horse.
I think it was Gift Horse as well, yeah. But that one, the mean girl crumples instantly. As soon as someone goes like, hey, don't be like that. She's like, I'm so sorry. Oh, God. So Melinda's the same way. It just crumples.
Well, this is like an 11-year-old girl we're talking about here.
True.
She doesn't know what she's doing. She's just following Dallas's example.
Yeah, and a grown man grabs her and shakes her so hard her head snaps back and forth. And she's like, I'm so sorry. And he goes, sorry? Not yet, you're sorry.
Yeah, sorry doesn't cut it.
Exactly. Yeah. So then Ginger gets her surgery on her leg that was going to cost 10 grand. And then, so I have these notes. I have, damn, Ben, did you get Ginger her surgery? 10K dropped just like that? Oh, damn, the vet comped it because she was an experiment. Oh, damn, Ben is paying the doc secretly. Blown away. Just reveals on reveals on reveals.
It's such a whirlwind, and you think maybe Ben's comfortable. You maybe he has like a super successful business and he's doing well, but he's in the lurch now.
Oh yeah,
as they would say.
But then, as they're leaving the doctor, Sonny, her mom Kathy, and Ben. Ben goes, "Hey, if you guys don't have any plans right now, there's something I want to show you." And her mom goes, "Oh, I'm sorry, but we do have plans." And Sonny goes, "No, we don't." And her mom goes, "Excuse me?" Like, furious with her daughter for blowing up her lie.
Yeah, Kathy's a real Kathy in this whole movie. She's just, she's all over the place.
Yeah. She's got a hard row to hoe. What does that mean? It means she's got a lot of problems.
Yeah, she's got hard rows and hoes.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
She's a stable maid.
Well, she's a buckle bunny. As they'd call her in To Tame a Wild Cowboy.
A buckle bunny?
A buckle bunny, yeah. Like a puck bunny,
right.
Or a... I don't know what other... Ski bunny, or... What are other kinds of bunnies?
Ski bunny, now I get it. Yeah. Now I'm right there with you.
This, P&V, you know?
Ooh.
I know.
Explicit.
I know. Ben buys Sonny a sweet... cowgirl hat. Buys her a white cowgirl hat.
Yeah.
Looks
so
pretty good.
Again, I feel like this movie is telling me that Ben is a successful person.
Yeah.
And he's got it like that. I mean, this hat looks like a couple $100 hat.
Hey, if he wants it like that, he can get it like that.
Well.
Cowboy hats, not cheap. At least a hundo for that hat. At least.
Yeah, unless you get it at Party City.
Well, exactly, yeah. And then it's $8 and it's pink and mesh and it's great. Also would have been a fine hat. Did you get, like, Jimmy Stewart vibes off of Ben? Because I was very much like, this guy could play Jimmy Stewart in a movie about his life.
Is Jimmy Stewart the guy that was Evel Knievel but with horses?
Yep, that's correct. That's what Jimmy Stewart was known best for. Starring in Westerns and also... He invented the Wild West Nitro Circus. Damn, Nitro.
Looking up Jimmy Stewart.
Yeah.
I say no.
Well, you're wrong, because he's a dead ringer for him, and he gives off that kind of vibe. He's a nice man, and you're wrong, so.
Oh, yeah, actually looking at his horse moves. Yeah, he's Jimmy Stewart.
He's doing backflips on horses, no problem.
No problem. Like, not even a trampoline in sight.
No. And Ben cleans up good. He gets rid of his mullet. He shaves his little day-old beard. He looks good. He looks like Jimmy Stewart.
Yeah, he cleans himself up. He's learning to live again.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But, well, he's learning to love again.
He's living. He's loving.
He's just a woman.
He's forgetting his dead daughter.
Yeah,
and...
he's doing everything he can to repress the memory of his dead daughter. Get it out
of
my head.
Yeah, that's why he sniffs so many things.
Yeah, that's why he sniffs a shovel with horse poop on it.
Oh, the dirt.
Oh, I'm going to get this horse jankum and see my dead daughter. Oh, no. Oh, it's doing the reverse of what I want.
Not the J word.
Oh, you can say jankum. That's fine. It's just a drug.
Is it in the Bible?
I believe so. I believe that's how everyone sees the burning bush and all that stuff. Whenever someone sees something spectacular in the Bible, what they leave out is that they were huffing jankum right before that happened.
Well, that's what my priest told me, but he's like reading the words between the words.
It's like jazz.
And yeah.
Yeah.
It's like jazz.
It's the words they're not saying that you're supposed to pay attention to.
Was it creepy that my priest would always mention jazz?
Yeah. Was it creepy that your priest would offer jankum to you after services? Yeah.
He would offer it to me, but it was in like a sly, cool way, like a cool young priest way.
Yeah.
Like, hey, look at that toilet. It might have jankum in it. It might not.
Hey, do you love the smell of other people's pee and poo? Well, have I got a treat for you? It's called jankum.
Yeah, double decker. That's how I make my jankum.
That's how I say. I really love the idea of, like, you've heard the description of angels in the Bible, right? Like, they're not people with wings. They're friggin', like, Cthulhu monsters. Like, they're just, like, eyes and shapes and wheels on fire. Just crazy stuff that is, like, oh, that's a Jankum hallucination. That's all that is.
Wheels on fire?
Yeah, wheels on fire, baby.
What does that mean? Is there, like, an angel that's just a wheel on fire?
Yeah, that's like a... Well, I don't know. I say that confidently, but, like, I'm pretty sure... Look, while I'm vamping, you should look up biblical angels. Look up pictures of biblical angels. Like, they look like... They look like schizophrenia. Like, they look like a thing that you just be like, oh, I'm losing my mind. Like, my brain is shattering apart right now because I'm huffing so much Jankum out of clay pots that I've made. Because it's the Old West. Oh, not... Well... Old East, I guess, in that regard.
Oh, yeah, that's like a creepy eye and yeah. Like a wheel on fire.
That's what it is.
It's a couple of wheels on fire.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
it's,
for sure.
Yeah. It's,
yeah,
it's
a lot of eye stuff, though.
Creepy. And, like, the fact that they would show up and be like, do not be afraid, and you're like, I can't promise that. I'm pooping in my pants right now. I'm not wearing pants. I'm wearing a robe, and so all the poop is just falling out onto the floor, which is great.
Do this dance.
Exactly. Anyway, I guess we've milked all we can out of Jankum in the Bible.
Well, milk is definitely the right word, and we're moving on.
You're nothing but a cactus-covered marshmallow, all right? How's that sound?
How many exclamation points did you put beside that phrase? Because I put 9.
I put 9, as in the German for none or no.
Oh, that's clever wordplay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
God bless.
So Hugh is just shooting his shot all over the place. He's like, he has Kathy over, and he's like, you know, I grew up in a big house, bigger than this house. I'm very rich. And what I never felt lonely because I had a family all around. And that's what makes a house a home, is when the right woman is there and the right family is there. And Kathy literally looks at the camera like Jim from The Office and is just like, I'm not going to marry this guy. That's a crazy thing to say, right? We've been together for less than 3 months, I'd wager.
Yeah. It's probably been a month to 45 days. This guy is a creepy loser. He's a 45-year-old doctor that apparently has never married or has anybody settled down for him.
Yeah. He's got a little sprig of white in his hair, and he's got a British accent that is not, like, I say British accent, but it's also kind of undefinable.
Yeah. It's off-putting.
Yeah. It's, what are you, brah?
You couldn't put it on pudding. It's definitely not on pudding.
No, certainly not. You go, where'd you learn that accent? And he would turn to the camera and go, I learned that from a Chinaman. Drink.
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 Drink. Drink.
Drink.
Yeah, drink.
We love you drinking.
Exactly.
Not too much.
No. Within limits. Know your limit, play within it. So,
hey, is that from something?
Yeah, gambling. No. So... Finally, Ginger is healed enough that Sonny can ride her, and Sonny's healed enough that she can ride Ginger. And her first ride on Ginger, she rides the piss out of Ginger. Like, she's a natural on that horse.
Yeah, I've never seen anything like it.
No.
She could be a future state champion for sure.
But she rides too much, and so Ben stops
her, much?
And he yells at her, and he shakes her, and he gives her grief. And then Hugh goes, oh, you were a little hard on her, weren't you? And Ben goes, you ever ridden a horse before, Doc? No? Well, then you stick to doctoring and I'll handle the horsing. It's like, yeah.
Shwabam.
Shut him down. He is trying to move on your future wife, bro.
I definitely don't think that he was supposed to shake that girl again. But he really made the director change his mind and really wanted to shake her again.
Mm-hmm. And he's like, you know what? It is better for the scene if we shake her. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's like, what?
That is an actor chosen shaking if I ever saw.
So we get, like, I don't know, a montage of her, like, practicing barrel racing and stuff like that to this song whose lyrics are Howling at the Sun, which is just
yeah.
nonsense. I Googled it, couldn't find that song anywhere.
She's got regionals on the brain, and she's howling at the sun.
Yeah.
She wants this life. She wants to beat the crap out of those other girls at barrel racing. And the one thing I learned about barrel racing during this movie is that if your hat falls off, you lose points.
that's true. We did learn that. I did learn something about barrel, like, actually, well, that's actual about barrel racing, but I learned that if you want to do good at barrel racing, keep your saddle horn, belly button, and the back of the saddle all lined up. Don't lean out of the saddle. Keep your belly button in line with your saddle horn and the back of the saddle, and you'll do fine.
Yeah, you gotta lean with the horse. Not too much, not too little. Mm-hmm. You gotta tip to taint, be super aligned.
Oh yeah, for sure. That's the way to do it. And that's barrel racing. Well, that's Gymkhana, as we find out.
Man, we're gonna be so good at horses after this summer. We're gonna be riding like crazy.
Yeah, we're gonna be cowgirls by the end of this summer, for sure.
Oh, I wish.
I can't wait to cut my garbage off and become a cowgirl.
Garbage? Is that like... What do you mean?
I'm just talking about my God-given peener. I'm going to call it my garbage, and I can't wait to cut it off.
I'm going to slice an inch off my backside and see if that works.
Good call. Starts right
I
out
got
of the
a
gate.
Big old butt.
But that's good. If you're going to be a woman, that's good. I mean, here's the thing. All the cowgirls I've ever known have had big old butts. Like,
really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Something about riding horses all the time gives you a great butt. Man or woman, I'll give it up to both. I don't care. I've known more cowgirls than cowboys, but they've all had great butts, and I'll say that proudly.
I thought riding horses would, like, glue your butt muscles into your spine.
Well, probably, but it makes them tough.
Yeah, big and juicy tough.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Like a couple of flank steaks.
Yeah, just like a Dodge truck.
Yeah, sponsor of this rodeo. Did you notice...
Steaks, at least.
Did you notice that during the Gymkhana when Sonny's riding around, she's yelling, hi-ya? She's going, hi-ya! Hi-ya!
Her yeah, horse. She learned that from a Chinaman.
Drink!
Hi-ya!
Hi-ya!
Oh no, my leg!
What a funny thing to yell while you're riding a horse. Hi-ya!
We don't know the race of her father. We didn't get to see the body. It was cut out and dumped in the ditch.
That's true. Could have been a Chinaman. Drink.
Drunk.
I liked the lyrics in this country song where they were talking about breaking down the walls of Jericho.
The music in this movie is all very explicit and gives detailed instructions of what the song wants you to do. Howling at the sun.
Turn to the right. Thing. Two steps to the left.
That was music in the 90s, though. That was country in the 90s.
Don't smell my fart, my stinky, stinky fart. You know? That's classics.
Yes!
Man, I feel like a cowgirl.
I really did. I was thinking about that song during this movie a lot.
So Hugh, he takes Kathy out for a ride in his new Porsche, and Kathy's like, oh, I've got to go pick up Sonny. And he's like, it'll just be a quick ride. And then he just drives her out into, like, nowhere and proposes to her. And she goes, I'm not ready for that. And he goes, all right, I'll drive you back to your stupid bitch daughter, I guess.
But keep the ring. Yeah, forget about your child. Let's go for a ride. You deserve it.
Yeah, keep the ring. Maybe it'll help my cause. Not when you put it like that, it won't. Ugh, that door's shut.
That's a good... That's a 10-gallon ring, though. She should have sold that at the end.
That's true. Oh, now we need to pay for this... I got to pay for this horse. Here, take my 10-gallon ring. And Hugh's just like, what? No!
Hugh's just in the background sulking.
We never see Hugh again after this. Hugh is gone after this. Isn't he?
Did you don't need him.
No, he's gone. Dunzo. He was a drive-by fruiting, and now he's gone.
Yeah, after Marry Me, Baby.
Exactly.
He's out of there.
And then we get to the biggest laugh I got in this movie, where Sonny is like riding. She's like, oh, I'm going to ride the barrels. And then Ben's like, oh, it's starting to rain. Come in. You can't. Don't ride the barrels while it's raining. And she's like, okay. And then he turns and she's just riding the barrels in the rain. And he's like, no, don't. And then lightning strikes and her horse rears up and falls on her. And I got the biggest laugh of the movie when Ben just runs out of the barn screaming, not again!
I don't know what it is about that line, because it's supposed to be maybe the most heartfelt line of the whole movie. It's really supposed to draw you into
his tragic.
Pain, but it's just funny.
Someone yelling not again to an absurd thing like that. Like, you would yell not again. If your daughter was killed because a horse got scared by lightning and fell on her, and then your surrogate daughter that you're training in the rodeo got scared by lightning and fell on your daughter, you would scream, not again! Why is this happening?
It would probably be the worst moment of your life other than when your child died.
This might be worse than when your child died, because at least you were like... Yeah. At least that was like a surprise. This is like, what is this? Why is this happening?
Yeah, for that to happen to a person twice in a lifetime would just be heartbreaking. You would go insane.
You would. You'd be like, I'm never riding a horse again. I'm opening a glue factory, and I'm assuring a horse never falls on a little girl ever again.
Yeah. You'd turn into a real Loveless after that point. You'd only concentrate on mechanical beings.
Yeah.
And you'd glue all your horses.
You'd call people Yella. And you'd build a big diesel-powered dingus to rail your beauties with.
Yeah, the beauties.
The beauties.
You always forget about the beauties.
Don't forget the beauties.
Mm-hmm.
So... Kathy rushes to the hospital. It turns out that her daughter's fine. A couple of scrapes, bump on her noggin, no concussion. She's okay. But I just had, like, there's this handsome nurse, like, tending to her daughter. And all I could think was, like, Kathy, don't go falling in love with this doctor now. Like, you just, I know this guy's way hotter than Hugh, so don't fall in love with him. He's very nice. But no.
That would have been a great turn if she didn't end up with Ben, spoiler alert. But she, like, just went for another doctor.
Yeah, like, at the end of the movie, we see her, like Ben's like, oh, maybe we could, like, get a drink sometime. And then we hear, like, hey, honey, I'm ready to go. And she turns, and it's just that nurse from earlier. And Ben's just like, what is this? You go to the hospital and date the people that take care of your daughter?
What if the nurse came up and just slaps her on the butt and starts making out with her right in front of him?
Ben would go, well, I guess time to cut my own throat with a spur, I suppose.
I guess we've never been on a date and she doesn't owe me anything. I guess I gotta move on.
Yeah, I'm a friggin' loser, I guess. I'm out of here. Yeah. Ben's rattled and he's like, well, first of all, Sonny takes full responsibility for what happens, which I respected her for that. I was like, you're a good kid. You recognized what you did was wrong and you took full responsibility and was like, it's not Ben's fault. Don't be mad at Ben, Mom. I need him as my dad. So I need you to fall in love with my dad, please.
This is her second big screw-up, though, and she should have been put on the sidelines.
Exactly. But nope. She loves it. Ben's, like, rattled, and he's like, I don't want to coach her anymore. But then Kathy lays it on him. She goes, you want to quit on her, Ben? Then do it yourself. So then he...
How about no?
Yeah. How about no, you freaky Dutch bastard?
Weird line, especially before that movie comes out.
Well, and especially because, like, there's nothing to indicate that either of them are Dutch.
Yeah.
But
they are
Dutch.
Well,
but there is a man named Dutch. There is a man named Dutch in this movie.
Right.
We can't forget that.
Maybe
that's all Dutch. That's who they're talking to. Hey, you want a drink of my booze that I drove over here to give you? How about no, you freaky Dutch bastard?
They're all freaky deaky Dutches.
True.
And you can smell it on them.
Oh, yeah. But then, hey, guess what? All is forgiven. Ben is like, I'll coach you again. How quickly can you get your cowgirl hat on? Let's get out of here. And she's like, ah! And then
let's go to states.
Yeah, let's go to state championship. But first we get a training montage that is all just old footage from earlier in the movie. There's no new footage shot for that training montage. It's just all the old stuff. It's very weird to see. And go like, wait, I recognize these shots.
Is this kind of the point where we find out that Melinda's, like, running her horse out of the just like running her horse too hard.
Yeah, running her horse out of the gate. You're supposed to. You got to.
She's not warming her up.
Yeah, you got to warm your horse up, or else you could injure it. They literally say that earlier in the movie. Oh, you're going to injure that horse if you ride it without warming it up. And then at States, Melinda and Dallas are late getting there due to traffic, so she doesn't have time to warm up her horse, and so she just comes ripping into the pen to like get started and frigs her horse's leg up.
Yeah, and this whole movie, Dallas has been on Melinda's butt. You got to be the champ. We got $100,000 riding on this and a scholarship to university.
Yep.
You can't go to camp.
No.
You got to ride this horse.
Right.
6 hours a day.
Yeah.
So, a lot riding on Melinda, doing well, but then she injures her horse and she's crushed. And you know how crushed she is? She's a little girl and she's literally yelling, "I want to die! I want to die!"
Totally okay for her to say this.
Totally
because,
normal.
Yeah, the world is on her shoulders and she has to win States.
I want to die. Like, oh my God, kid. You're like 10. What are you talking about? Childhood depression wasn't even a thing in the 90s like it is today.
Well, it wasn't recognized for sure, but I understand how she felt.
No, oh, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. As soon as I saw Steel hurt, I was like, I want to die. Steel.
Yeah, I grabbed onto my couch cushions and went, I want to die with you.
Well, Sonny is the sweetest little girl in the whole wide world. She offers Ginger in replace of Steel and is like, look, you need this more than I do. I don't give a shit about this rodeo. You have your whole life hanging in the balance because of this friggin' rodeo. Take Ginger and win this race. Ginger's the only horse that could match Steel.
Yeah.
And so she does.
Well, she also thinks that her mom's going to choose the doctor. She's really invested into that relationship and wants that money. She wants that big house.
Of course. She talks
about it a lot.
Oh, mommy, send me to the big house. And she's like, you got to murder someone first. You gotta have blood on your hands first.
Yeah, exactly.
So then Melinda does the barrel racing on Ginger, sets a new state record of 14.9 seconds, which is, wow, that's fast.
Yeah. A lot of these movies are going to have state records.
Yeah, shattered. Broken and then shattered.
This isn't the first state record we've seen throughout these movies, and it won't be the last.
I do love when she rides out on Ginger, and the announcer goes, well, she was supposed to be riding Steel, but now she's riding Ginger, which was supposed to be run by Sonny Matthews. Well, that's rodeo for you.
That's what happens. Happens all the time during the rodeo. There's swip-swapping horses. There's backroom deals being made.
Yeah. Oh, this girl's not going to compete, but this other girl's going to ride her horse instead, and that's rodeo for you. What are you going to do, right? No rules laws.
Looks like Sonny lost a bad hand of poker last night to Melinda.
Well, that's rodeo for ya. Sorry. Melinda wins. Congratulations. Steel is off to the glue factory. Bye-bye, Steel. You're going to be turned into dog food. And then Kathy wants to be with Ben, I guess. Like,
yeah.
It's weird how she says it, too. She's like, you know, I don't want to be with the doctor anymore because, A, I don't love him. B, he doesn't ride a horse. And C, I think I found someone I like better. And Ben goes, do I know him? Yeah, it's you, idiot.
Well, his reaction is kind of, like, appropriate because they've had no, like, dates or stolen glances even.
Nothing to indicate.
There's been no energy.
No. Just at the end, she goes, and because this is a movie, let's fall in love and make our family complete. Well,
Ben is a four-time world champion at something.
Got a citation from the president.
He also got a citation from the president-elect.
Yeah, from Bill Clinton. Well, probably from George Bush Sr., I would imagine.
Yeah, back in the day, it would have been Sr., for sure.
From Richard Nixon, he got one of these. He is old. He's a very old man.
Tricky Dick, and I can say that because it's in the Bible.
And that's his nickname. Yeah, Jesus had a tricky dick. He tells everyone that.
He really emulated his life over Jesus.
Well, here's the thing. as we find out if you read the Bible, Jesus invented puppetry of the penis. That's like a thing that Jesus is responsible for. So if you've ever seen...
He did gum?
He did gum, yeah. He invented the bat wing. He invented brain. He invented all the puppetry of the penis.
I mean, of course it started off with gum, something they didn't have back then.
No, of course not. Yeah, first he had to invent gum, and then he invented... Then he was like, hey, check this out. And he pulled his tricky dick out and did some stuff with it. And they were like, that looks like gum, the thing you invented.
Yeah, lost story of the Bible is the gum story.
Yeah. Mary Magdalene was like, you should see what he can do with that thing. He can turn it into gum. He can stretch it out and look like a bat wing. He can scrunch it all up so it looks like a brain. That's more puppetry of the testicles than anything else, but it doesn't matter.
Well, that's how... That's how he got the best prostitute in town, was yeah. his gum work.
Exactly. Have you ever seen Puppetry of the Penis?
No, I haven't. I just expect it's a bunch of guys making gum.
Yeah. It's exactly, yeah. It's a lot of like, and this one's an upside down elephant, and now it's time for the upside down elephant, and...
This is a upside down elephant with gum in its nose. That sort of thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. This one's called the upside down uncircumcised elephant, and then they flop it around and
They just do a handstand.
Yeah, it's just that's all it is. It's just for 90 minutes, two Australians.
Like, 90.
Isn't it crazy to think that it was just a show where people just flopped their dongers out on stage and people paid big money for it? People were like, we want to see what you could do with those dongers, dudes. And they showed them.
That might have been the height of white privilege.
It's why the terrorists hate us.
Yeah. And, okay.
Yeah, fine. Fair enough. I hate us too for puppetry of the penis. I get it. It's a bad thing. Jesus invented it. Terrorists hate Jesus, so obviously they're going to hate puppetry of the penis.
Very true. Very absolutely true.
Yep, not
a lie. Do you think that Dr. Hugh Olsen had a chance if he would have ridden a horse once?
Maybe. I feel like if they would have had a scene where he rode a horse... It would have been like that girl in the last cowboy like rodeo movie we watched that was riding a horse holding the flag, just flopping back and forth out of control.
How cool would that have looked, though?
Really cool.
He would have given that doctor a flag.
Really cool, actually.
It would have been better than how they actually ended this movie.
No, the way they actually ended this movie was perfect. Are you kidding me? Just a montage of clips we've seen before?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then maybe, you know how, is it The Breakfast Club? Or what is the movie with the iconic freeze
with
frame
the
at the
fist?
End? Yeah, with the fist. Is that The Breakfast Club? Yeah, I've never seen that.
That's Beat Club.
Yeah, okay. So that's, people say that that's the most iconic freeze frame in movie history, but that's not true. They haven't seen Second Chances yet. This movie has the most iconic freeze frame I've ever seen. It's a backlit shot of somebody riding a horse at dusk, so the lighting's bad. They're totally in shadow. And then she just raises both her arms in the air, and we get a 24-second freeze frame. I counted. 24 seconds it's frozen.
Okay, how'd you count? Was it Mississippi's or
no,
was it screen
time? I looked at the time. I watched. Soon I brought up my little mouse, and I looked at when the freeze frame started, and then I looked at when it faded fully to black. Because the fade out took like 2 seconds or 3 seconds, but I'm still counting that because it was still on the screen. But it's just a blurry freeze frame of somebody cloaked in shadow. We can't even see if it's sunny or not. It's... presumably it's sunny, but you can't tell. And it's 24 seconds. Did the movie break? Why is it still frozen? 24 seconds.
It broke.
It did.
Definitely.
Guys,
they get $1 for every second this film takes.
I have a feeling this movie was 24 seconds under the time that they had been paid to make it. And they went, what if we just put a 24-second freeze frame at the end? Could we do that?
I'm guessing it was the riding double that they used for both Melinda and Sonny. Because they definitely used the same girl.
The grown woman doubling for these 10-year-olds. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Well, grown short woman.
No, yes. No. Fully grown woman. Just heaving her breasts and squeezing this horse. And, yeah.
Maybe it was the nanny.
Hey. Nope, I don't know anything about the nanny. I can't even riff on that. I'm sorry.
Friend Drescher.
Yeah, yeah. That's how she sounds, right?
Yeah.
Hey, what did you think
Sounds like Owen Wilson.
What did you think of puppetry of the penis?
I thought it was great. I really liked the upside down elephant. I thought the upside down elephant with gum was hilarious.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I didn't think they could make 90 minutes of fun from that sort of thing, which I am not accustomed to.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved it. What do you think of puppetry of the vagina?
I thought it was good. I liked the bat wing. I liked the brain. I thought that both of those were pretty classic. Yeah, you know, I didn't think they could stretch it into 90 minutes, but here we are talking about it. So they obviously did their job well.
Okay, here's a sincere question about puppetry of the penis.
Sure.
Have you seen the whole thing?
Yeah, I saw all 90 minutes of it.
Did they do gum?
I love you.
I love you.
We
love you.
We love you.
If you're going to be a cowgirl, you got to be tough. The
best thing. Oh yeah, that clip at the start is from this movie, where Buddy goes, "You want to be a cowgirl? Summer. You got to be tough."
Is that going to be our theme from now on? Now
I think so. Yeah, I like it. Do you like it?
I love it. I just didn't think of it. Wondered if it was a one-off or not.
No, no. I think it's worth keeping.
Yeehaw.
Yeehaw. I'm going to see if all of Puppetry of the Penis is on YouTube. There's a chance it is, and I want to watch it. I want to see what it is.
Ooh, I want to see gum.
Man, I feel like a cowgirl.
This is our summer theme song.
Ain't no sense.